Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Regular scheduled meeting of Sunderland Board of Selectmen. It's April 24th, 2017. Please call to order at 6:40. First up is Sarah Snyder with a quick update on the Community Pathway Committee.
Hello. I'm coming to talk about the Complete Streets project tonight. We have an opportunity to put in a request for $400,000 worth of projects that will make our streets safer for pedestrians and bicyclists and people on wheels. As you know, we've jumped through a bunch of hoops already on this opportunity, and with the help of Kirk, I've got a very detailed plan for all of the projects, a very thorough plan. And our task now is to select $400,000 worth to request for this year. And we've been working very hard. Dan Murphy's done a lot of kind of scoping of the projects. We've been talking and meeting with George Emery and with the Burcott Transportation Planners and Sherry and the Pathways Committee. I went over it with the Planning Board. And we wanted to present you our recommendations for what projects to request. There are a lot of complications. We're looking for projects that these would have to be completed within the next fiscal year. So they have to be kind of shovel ready. And we're looking for projects that are kind of not too hard and don't require a lot of design work. Those are our criteria also that fit within the $400,000. So the projects that we're recommending, we're not quite, it's going to take a few more days to finalize it because there's some questions out to the state and so on. But the projects we're recommending are on River Road, rehabbing and extending the sidewalks on River Road. Then on Old Amherst Road, improving the putting in new crosswalks,
right,
and crossing signals at various locations along Old Amherst Road. The next one is on adding sidewalks on Hadley Road that will connect the apartments to the sidewalks on Old Amherst Road.
Yeah.
The next one is on Garage Road, at the end of Garage Road, that left fork up the hill to North Silver, adding a sidewalk there because there's a lot of pedestrian traffic and there's very poor visibility, and that's a big safety concern. So we actually, on this plan, is to look at that entire intersection, but that's one of the things that'll take more design. So we want to just take off the piece of putting in that sidewalk for now. George plans to resurface River Road from Old Amherst about a mile south this year, and so we want to look at a gateway treatment. We're not sure what it would be, but it's on the plan to consider some kind of gateway treatment to calm traffic coming north.
That makes sense. There's a fair amount of hustle. It seems like there's a lot of initiative to get north on that road.
Right.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Yeah, so, finally, we can have one more big project. The sidewalks and pedestrian lighting on School Street is a big priority, but that's one work that we think we can't fund it all through the Complete Streets because part of the sidewalk is out of the right-of-way, and we're waiting for a final call on that. But we think we might need to apply for some CCA funding and wait a year and combine it with the whole park project.
That makes sense.
Right.
Yeah, because if we wait a year, it would be on the same timing. We're presuming we get the park grant, it would be with that. But the other one, the backup is the sidewalks on South Main Street, on the east side of South Main Street. We could, to rehabilitate those sidewalks and do some, we're not sure, in the project is a piece of painting, sharrows, the, you know, bicycle,
markings.
And I'm not sure whether we'll ask for that piece now, because if the intersection's gonna be.
Oh, yeah, if that gets changed, right.
Right, if we don't, those, that paint, that road paint costs a lot of money.
It does.
Yeah, so we're not sure if the timing will make sense. Those are some of the wrinkles we're still ironing out. But those are the projects that make the most sense to all of us who've been talking about it to pursue now. We have this week to put the request in. I think it's due May 1st.
May 1st, that's why the push. We're hoping that, to bring the recommendations to the board for your approval and have the paperwork for you to sign on Friday.
Right.
Yeah.
Time is everything.
And the one thing about it is that this program, the Complete Streets Program, does not fund design. Where have you heard this before?
Right over there.
Yeah.
So we've chosen ones that aren't gonna need a lot of design, but we're told that you should allow like 8 to 10% for design. So the town may need to come up with up to $40,000 for design in order to get all this $400,000 worth of improvements in our infrastructure.
So we're gonna wait for, you're gonna have the recommendation for Friday night?
Yes, we should have everything for you.
Okay.
I had actually one question, if I could, Mr. Chair. So over the course of the work of the Pathways Committee, as well as the information presented to the board, there was a prioritization.
Correct.
And is this in keeping with that prioritization, this list, or are we kind of fitting into a maximum of 400K?
Correct. It's not, we're not going exactly with the prioritization that was in this plan. We don't have to.
Right.
And we have to select, for instance, South Silver Lane sidewalks were number 3, but that's a very complicated project. There's like a lot of,
A lot of work involved.
Yeah, design work. There's a lot of, I can't remember but there's stuff with water and, you know.
The drainage issues, a little more than we originally thought.
Yeah, so that one we wouldn't be ready to do. Another, like the school street is higher in priority, but like I said, I don't think we can fund, it turns out we can't fund it all with this program, so we're gonna need to wait and do a CPA request. Old Amherst Road sidewalk reconstruction is gonna cost $505,000, so we can't do that. So there's certain reasons.
So we went through the list and kind of fitted them to this grant round.
Correct.
To make sure that we could, if we could pick off of the list that's been vetted, right, reviewed, and we could fit them in.
Yeah.
The second question, if I could, Mr. Chair, is under the design, having gone through what's going on, having gone through the machinations of 120 North Main, design can become, you have to comply to our standards or ask for exceptions. How much of these projects do we know, or should we be concerned about our standard design, whether it's MassDOT or Travel Safe, or I'm making a name up right there because that's a future agency, I'm sure.
It's right? On the drawing board
already. Some kind of mass standard that's associated with the design.
Right.
Right.
You know, and that may be compliant or non-compliant. I'm just curious because design project erosion of 8 to 10% is 8 to 10% less stuff people are walking on, and it's 8 to 10% of the total cost. It looks like this.
Right. Yeah.
It would be interesting to find out if we don't have the answer.
Yes.
I don't have the answer. Dan, who's a, you know, town engineer for town of East Hampton, pre-scoped all of these projects. He's pretty familiar with the requirements.
Smart.
And that's why some of these, like School Street, got bumped.
Makes sense.
Because sort of
low-hanging fruit.
His knowledge of the requirements. So the ones that we've selected are ones that we think are not gonna run into those kind of complications. I think when we get to wanting to do the shared use path on South Main, that to extend from North Main, that...
Back to standard design practice or exception, yeah.
Right.
That makes sense.
But this has,
Well, just to say that it's a five-year plan, so it'd give us an opportunity to look at other funding sources to design, whether it's Chapter 90 stabilization or perhaps CPA funds.
Sure.
So just so we can get our ducks in a row, we did try to kind of pick the low-hanging fruit so we could at least move forward and get going.
Great, and before I go any further, thanks for all the work, for the whole group.
Yeah,
there's a lot of work that went into it, so.
We're really excited that everything is coming together, and this town is gonna feel really different in 4 years walking around here.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting.
That's all, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions, David?
No, I'm sort of a part-time member of the committee, I guess, sort of, so. But yeah, and it's a very good piece of coordination, like we're getting a lot of things well coordinated, so it'll be good.
Okay, good. Then Friday night before the town meeting, we won't have anything to do.
Okay.
We won't have anything to do, exactly. Thanks so much.
Okay,
thanks.
Thanks, Sarah.
Okay.
All right, minutes from 4:18.
Very end, right?
Yeah.
Yep, there we go. Motion.
I'll second the motion.
Motion made and seconded. All any discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. 3-0, Sherry. Town budget review. So before we go there, under more other important dates to remember, we should have 4/28/17 next Board of Selectmen's meeting.
Oh, okay.
Right, we have at least one agenda item on it.
Streets approved.
Yeah.
Okay. 6:30. All right. Town budget review. Where do we stand? Mr. Moderator, do you want to look at this budget? Or do you want to look at this budget? All right, let's go through this guy.
This is the town meeting format budget. I'm sure maybe we could just update over the course of the last, from our last meeting to this weekend, from our last meeting to this week, there were two additions. One was the compensation component that wasn't carried forward for the highway department, laborers. That was something we had to add. And there was a police department expense that wasn't captured, and that's also included in this budget. Was there anything else?
That was it.
So just those two items. Okay.
So let's make a note. We always get this where there's always like one department that gets left forgotten. Why wouldn't we? I'm going to go out on the limb here.
Yeah, go.
But in my opinion, the personnel committee should have a recommendation by the start of the budget process.
Okay. So timing, yep.
I think that has a lot of bearing on the budget.
Sure.
Why would we, and if they're talking about a COLA increase, why wouldn't the COLA increase be applied at that time?
Right.
Instead of, it always seems like there's one highway department this year, library last year.
Sure. I think last year was actually at town meeting as well. There was some negotiating on the floor because something wasn't carried forward.
Right.
There was. Yeah.
So Sherry, I'd like for next year that we have a COLA. The COLA should be stated by the personnel committee up front right away. Mm-hmm. And we shouldn't be carrying zero unless the COLA is zero.
And to provide, if I could, Mr. Chair, to provide kind of background to people who may or may not be watching, the selectmen send out the letter saying level, what the guidance. We send out the guidance letter early.
Right.
And many of the departments carry that right through, waiting for some other decisions, whether it be personnel or capital or whatever. And that's, I think what I'm hearing is that's where the tension lies. We had a one department, 1 week move, only because simply wasn't added.
And if I could just make a comment, too, that there were two personnel changes in that department,
that's
too.
A good
we
point,
had
too.
The two brothers that retired, yep. And two new guys that
came in.
So there were changes
got it.
At that point as well that weren't reflected in
an early budget.
Yeah.
Good point.
Yeah.
But to your point about a systematic approach and the calendar, you're right.
Well, I would say the personnel committee should be, their goal is to have a recommendation for January, because that's when our budget's put together. So I would say that's instead of, you know, waiting toward the end, and again it happens, like I said, it's not the first year, not just saying this year, but it happens quite often. So
good point.
All right.
So, well, once we get the numbers from the prior calendar year, then we should be able to plug those into the formula for the COLA.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Because it's just, you're just relying on
absolutely.
Economic data from the previous year.
Right.
And the calendar that we have is pretty easily modified. You simply have that recommendation by blank.
Put a calendar reminder out there and it'll pop up. COLA time. And then.
Okay. Well, or and have the recommended budget, I mean, have your expand two or three columns and have, you know, request, you know, have a requested line.
Yep. Yep.
Have a COLA line, have a zero, have a COLA, you know what I mean?
Yep.
So I think it'd be look at a little bit.
Do that, tweak it.
Yeah, tweak that a little bit.
And that could be separate from actually this document. I actually like, from our prior meetings, the document that shows where we've gotten to, but a working document could easily be 1 year plus the three columns you're talking about, or machination.
Correct.
And then once it's decided, it ends up in this format again.
Absolutely.
Good point.
All right. So general government. Now, general government, that includes the select board, the accountant, the assessors, the
treasurer collector, right?
The treasurer collector,
elections, committees and boards, our new energy line as well, mm-hmm. that consolidated energy line, all of our buildings, that's yeah. all in general government. I'm sorry.
No, town buildings is separate.
You're right.
Well, I'm looking at, I'm on our budget right here. I'm looking at, it says total TC treasurer.
Yep.
So the tax, it's tax collector, not town clerk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it goes right up right. to buildings.
Yep. Correct. All right.
That's
it goes
side.
Total elections, committees and boards. All the way up to town buildings. Town building, we have a separate line.
Right.
So all of that's 2.4% increase. That's. Would you think there's any questions about that, Mr. Moderator? We'll get back to presentations, but I'm just saying, is there a reason to have anything? You see anything more? I mean, that's pretty straightforward. Those.
Usually don't get any.
All right. The next item on that is the town buildings. We show a 56.9% increase, but that's because we're putting in that $120,000 for the because of our PV. So we're having that one line item for the PV electric. So we're putting that into this line item. So we're taking out of some of the other buildings. So like the town office energy, we reduce that by $10,000. The highway energy, we reduce it by $3,000. Reduce the public library by $17,000. The public safety complex by $11,000. So we're taking that money out. because we have that $120,000 coming in.
And then it carries to other parts of the budget, $13,000 for the streetlights. It all adds up to the $120,000.
Yeah.
Right, it's just a matter of removing it.
Yep.
Doing it differently.
So do you have a, it shows 56.9%, but that's actually reducing some other line items to accommodate.
Yeah. Right, because if you look at just percentages and you don't know about it, you're gonna wonder why did it go up.
All right, police department. Mr. Bergeron, you wanna talk about that for a second?
Yeah, if I could, Mr. Chair. Right now, the police department itself, we have contract negotiation we're near completion on. We have the first full year of funding of last year's chief expenses. We have a chief at a higher rate who was only a partial year last year. And there's a expense growth in there. Part of that expense growth was additional time required in training, and part of that expense growth was also is baked into the police chief's contract. And I'll be really clear about it. The police chief lives in Barrie, and in our negotiations, the town felt it wasn't appropriate to have a cruiser from Sunderland in Barrie all the time. So we have a 20-mile circle around the town of Sunderland. And then beyond that 20-mile circle, we pay the IRS rate for him to use his own car. And again, that's a straight expense. We chose not to put that in salary. And if you look at cruisers, I think we got a quote of 40 and change, 47,000 on a 3 to 5 year cycle, tracking back and forth to Barrie. We felt that this was more appropriate. So we built that into the expense side. And I mean, perfectly candid about that. So that's where we see some of that growth. There is, and maybe there is opportunity still for a little growth in this, depending on where we are this year. Sherry and I have to look tomorrow morning. If we come to an agreement on the contract structure, this may tick up a little more, only in that the percentage of COLA right now is carried for the existing contract. So, we're talking about five full-time employees.
Okay, the fire department, we'll see the fire department's going down 10%, but that's part of...
That's kind of misleading, isn't it?
Part of the fire department is South County EMS budget, and South County EM budget to the town of Sunderland went down a little bit. By that amount to $27,901 because of use of what they call retained earnings. That's the buzzword that the state uses for a enterprise fund. They call it retained earning. So the Board of Oversight used a little bit at their discretion. They reduced the assessments to the town by using some of the retained earnings. Inspectors, basically we're down to 2.1%. That's because of the again with streetlights, how we're looking. Yep. That's under the inspections and other protection. Streetlights is listed under there. And we're looking at the streetlights we're picking up in that $120,000 energy line. So that's why that line's down and the other line is up. Highway, total highway, 3.3%.
So one thing that is in there, again, Mr. Chair, if I could, is that some of the maintenance expense, highway maintenance expense, was added, $2,000 of additional. And then again, our highway labor wages with the two of the hires, the new hires.
Yep.
So again, a total of, just right here, $8,822 at the highway department.
I think it's funny, you see a 12% increase in your seasonal highway, but
yeah.
It's only $500
right.
More,
but yeah.
A 12% increase.
You know what right. Is missing, and this—it's too late in the game right now for this discussion. But You know, we had ticked up snow and ice materials and snow expenses and snow and ice wages. And it looks like we're gonna tick up nothing this year in snow and ice.
No.
So we have a deficit we're gonna pay off. It's a tough winter. It's one of the few areas we can deficit spend outside of an emergency that's declared. But I guess going forward, next budget cycle, it'll be worth asking the highway superintendent if that 47, in particular on things like the expense, raw materials.
Like stuff. Right. Yeah, because we went through a lot this past year.
Correct.
Yep.
Highway department's up, like I said, 3.3%. Health and sanitation looks at the solid waste, bulky item day, hazardous waste, landfill monitoring, Riverside Cemetery, care of veterans' graves, Board of Health clerk, Board of Health expense, and we're up zero on that. The library budget is up 5.5%. There's a increase of 6% in the library director wages, and there's additional $4,145 in the support wages. Elementary school, and the elementary school is up 5.2%. The Franklin County Tech Assessment's up 3.7%. Frontier Regional School is up 1.5%. 1%?
1 plus transportation, so yeah,
1.5. Transportation for Frontier's up $7,662, which is 39%, which is a 39%. So that increase plus the Frontier's what we end up with, the total 1.5%. But their budget's only up 1%. Out of yes, we do. That's out of district placement, and that's going to be, we have two students of $34,000, and out of district transportation is $11,610.
It was the district tuition actually that dropped a whisker, but I'm sure that's their own budget, internal budget process. They assign cost of attendance being out of district.
Well, I mean, we're trying to do best we can with the transportation.
Yeah. Oh, I agree.
But it's difficult. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to provide transportation. And unfortunately, one or two students is very expensive. Benefits and insurance. The biggest thing we have dollar-wise is our insurance. The town insurance is the town employees' medical projected to go up $65,000, which is about a 28.6% increase. Part of that is because the rates are going up. Part of it's because additional employees are taking health care as well. So in the benefits and insurance, we're increasing by $91,279. We really don't have a whole bunch to say about that. And that's a 14.5% increase. Next up is our miscellaneous South County Senior District Vet Assessment, Soldier Vets Benefits, Reserve Fund, Capital Stabilization. We're actually down a little bit this year, 4.3% on totals up because of a couple of things. So the total line item is 110,905, which is down by about 4.3%. So that gives us our total operating budget of $7,007,349, which is a $323,875, which is a 4.8%. Wastewater is budget 307,1116, which is down 7.7%. The debt and interest is down. We're at 259,780, down 1%. So our grand total is $7,574,245, which is an increased budget of $295,780, which is 4.1%.
Of those numbers, total operating budget number, or the running total, which one of those triggers the 2.5%?
I would say out of those numbers, it would be, in my opinion, is the operating budget itself.
The operating budget does.
And
the other part is paid for by the
soldiers. Well, our debt interest has been pretty stable over the last few years, and actually has been decreasing. Things have been coming off from our debt and interest line area. The wastewater is done by fees. I guess now's probably a good time to discuss, you know, when you've asked the other day about, and I'm still trying to understand how we put together, and we're going to talk about that in a couple of minutes. But if you look at the major changes, I would say in our health and benefits, we have a $91,000 change. 91,279. That's a big one. Between all of the schools, between Frontier, the elementary, Franklin Tech, we have $152,301. $152,301. Those are the two big ones right there.
Yeah, so if you look, I could, Mr. Chair, if you look at the total operating budget to the moderator's question, below that line in our detail fund, our detail sheet, wastewater is paid by users.
Yes.
And then we have on the debt and interest, we have some short-term debt, and that short-term debt, Title V, sewer, which is paid by the sewer users, and energy are not excluded. So we pay bans on, we will be paying bans on the energy PC principal and interest, right?
Mm-hmm.
We'll be paying a ban on interest on short-term debt, and that's a budgeted number that the accountant has developed, or we have developed, the financial team has developed. But the library principal and the public safety principal are all debt excluded.
Right.
So those pieces there, you know, although they're on the tax rate, they are gone when that debt is retired. So the other smaller pieces of debt, those bands, right, they actually need to be raised each year, and they're townwide. So if you looked at all of that debt right there at 259, if you looked at that debt at 259, the reality is 55. Well over half of that is excluded debt. It will, once it's retired, it simply comes off the tax rate. So to your record, just one more, Mr. Chair. If you look at that 323,875, that is the total government, total operating budget. I'm looking at the detail sheet, Bob. That's the piece right there where year after year after year, those percentages get away from us when we have a 2.5 in new growth combined of about 160. You can only take in 160,000 year after year and have expenditures of 300,000 year after year before something happens. And I would say one other piece with respect to this budget, just like quietly in years prior, there are some fundamental shifts in here. One is that we are slowly but surely coming toward being near electricity consumption neutral in next to our generation.
That's
every
true.
Year that goes forward, that debt we have with Kearsarge drops a little bit. And as long as our production, which is guaranteed, continues up, we should see those two numbers intersect. And then electricity drops should hit budgets, future operating budgets. Again, not exclusively this year. This is year one. And what's missing from this on the revenue side is, through guidance from our consultant, don't bank on year one yet. See a full
it's
year of production, right? Budget the expense, see a full year of production, and then next year, you can really look at that revenue stream minus what we owe in the debt for that, or the lease for that, excuse me. So there's one that's strategic. We look at it one, like, budgets are like a single frame in a movie. 25 years later, the movie whisks by and it makes something out of it, right? In this case here, you look at this one frame and go, all right, well, it's 4%. What's up? What's going on with that? There's a fair amount of it that's on the education side and the benefits and insurance side. Those two combined for over $200,000 just by themselves of the 300.
How many more years on the public safety contract before that's paid off?
Five.
About 5 years.
As well as the library. 2021?
2021.
Yeah, 21. So really, actually, based on this budget, four. It's tough living in 3 years at a time.
All right. So, Mr. Moderator, have you thought about budget presentation, something that you'd like to hear? Or, you know, how would you recommend that presented?
How would I recommend?
Yeah. Well, understanding that people probably talk to you about things they like or dislike in the past.
I don't know how else you present it. That's the thing. They're numbers.
They're not exciting.
Something that looks out of place, I mean, it's a high number, you know, you offer the explanation for it, and that's all. That's what you guys have been doing.
Well,
what else you can do? Some people will accept the fact that the cost of living is going up, just like theirs is the town's.
Right.
They don't think the town's does, and you can't do anything there anyway.
Right.
Can't argue with those people. The other people are going to say, well, you know, this is a rational increase. It's just when the increases are perceived as out of line, that's where you get into trouble. That's where you really have to make the explanations.
Yeah, and that's where, like, that percentage you were bringing up earlier, you have to be careful and know, because if you look at just percentage increases, you say, oh, this particular line item went up X percent. That seems like a lot until you look at it. Oh, it's only like $500 or something. So then it's like, okay. So then, you know, that's where you have to go into the background of it.
I did prepare for the board's review a town meeting handout that kind of summarized the articles and explained some of the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that we could maybe use as a town meeting handout and just as informational to put online.
That's a good point.
Definitely online.
Get some of the information.
Yeah, we can do that. Yeah, we can do that.
Just get it out online and be out there immediately.
I had town council check it just to make sure that it.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that we're not.
Yeah.
The increase in the cost of benefits, you know, that's a big jump.
Sure.
Is it because of an increase in the number of employees?
Take, well.
Packages?
Part of it's a benefit package that the employees take, but there was also a, the, we've been exceptionally lucky over the last three, four, 5 years that we have had very minimal increases from the Hampshire group that we get our insurances from. This year, they're putting in a 10% increase. So when you put that 10% increase plus people going to different plans, and again, sometimes you don't know how people are taking, what plans are taking. So we've built in a little bit, there's built in a little bit of extra, I don't know if extra, but there's contingency in that budget. And again, you could cut something like that out, but the problem is if you. And right, and typically in the benefits, we've had a pretty good, for insurance-wise, we've had a pretty good estimation over the years. We haven't found ourselves short in that area that often. And also we do some investigation to find out what people are trying to do also. So, I mean, it should be a pretty good number. I think one of the things that is a concern to me is the Frontier budget. Not because it's up 1.5% this year, just the opposite. I'm very happy this year is a 1.5%. But our residents need to understand how that number occurs, and they go through a 5 or 6 year rolling number. So Sunderland had some pretty high numbers. So our percentage was going up, playing in the cost. We've been replacing some very high numbers with very much lower numbers. So we're paying less. But right now, Sunderland is the only school that's seeing an increase in their students, in the student population. And after, what, 2 or 3 years, that's going to change.
Right.
Sunderland's numbers are going to start increasing. And I think we get another 2 years or
yeah,
so.
I would say.
Another 2 years, and then all of a sudden you're going to see Sunderland's numbers start to increase. And when they start to increase, because Whiteley, Conway, Deerfield are not increasing. I'm not saying they're decreasing, but they're not increasing.
Yeah, not as fast as us.
We're going to pay more because we have more students.
Right.
But that's going to happen. And I would hope our elementary budget, when you look at the numbers of kids in the classrooms, it seems to be in a position right now where they're not, and again, I can't, you never know, you may get inundated with fourth graders that move into town, but right now it seems that we have a little flexibility in that they could go up or down a few students and it wouldn't trigger adding staff. So I think in that respect we're okay. But you never know what happened with an individual's education plan also, their IEPs. Scott?
As a matter of course, historically, if you looked at the year between FY14 and FY15, which seems a decade ago, but really was just 3 years, Frontier had a $152,000 increase. So we're in that spot between the formula and the population and their actual operating expenses. I give them credit, and their impact with Chapter 70. I give them credit with that as well. So having a modest increase this year, it doesn't take many years in the rears to look and see where it really hurts. I mean, that number alone is equal to and or greater than the given year of all of our 2.5 growth. That one line. so.
And I think if you were to ask, you know, you say, what is the greatest draw driving the increase or the 2.5? It's not just this year's increases, but we were able to absorb last year's increases also. And last year, the budget increased, elementary budget increased by 10.6%. And when you throw this year's on top of it, it didn't allow you to take a breath.
Right. And that kind of was along the lines with last year's increase of like the state telling us that we needed to pay more. So
that was part of the thing the state said. Yeah. And it's infinite wisdom that.
That's right. You need to pay more.
But again, yes. that's why sometimes just looking at numbers isn't enough. Right. Yeah, I mean, you have to, you know, the understanding of it. Now, I feel confident that the schools aren't asking for monies that they don't need. We see the numbers. We see the increasing student population. But I would hope in the very near future that we just can't continue with those increases. So that's what we're trying. And so really the override is to try to reset, is trying to get us on our feet. I mean, because if you look at the town side, and again, not trying to present one against the other, but if you look at where our growth is, the growth isn't in the core segments of our budget. It's with our education and health and benefits right now. And on the education portion of it, what we have learned is that you can say you're not going to support that portion of the budget, but if you don't support that portion of the budget, that increase of $150,000 or whatever, we could lose it with 3 or 4 kids that go out to charter school.
There's a cost, and
we have seen that. And that's just black and white. That's just math.
It'll be interesting to see if the demographic shift continues over the next several years.
We'll see. Yep. So I don't know how we can alter. I've been thinking over the last week of how, and because you make a right point, how do you put together a presentation? And that's why we came up, that was one reason we came up with this budget instead of this budget, is because we had too many. I mean, the numbers are sort of important, are important to us because we look at them all the time. But most people don't look at that. How much does my police department? How much does it cost for fire? How much does it cost for police? How much does it cost for town government? Those are the important things. If somebody wants to know what the fire chief makes or the police chief makes or whatever, we have those numbers. We can find those numbers and we can come in anytime and ask Sherry or the accountant, treasurer, collector, whoever, and that we get that information.
Would an approach be to just single out fact that one, the budget is going up. The budget is going up primarily because of two things, schools and benefits. And at the beginning, just say that we recognize that they're going up, we get the school budget, we can discuss it, but the budget is in line with what they have to have. And same with the benefits. What control do you have over benefits?
Your question is well put, because Sunderland pays 55% of the benefits. Sunderland's lucky because of some laws that are out there now when it deals with benefits, health care. By statute, you have to provide certain levels of money. We are technically right on the verge of not qualifying.
Not affordable by definition.
So, you got to try to explain that to people. I would say, you know, you look at our surrounding communities. Well, you know, like Whiteley pays 75% or 80%. Deerfield pays, I think, 65% or 70%. We don't set the bar for paying the most on our health care.
See, those are some of the things I would think that an explanation to the folks that are there, as well as the few that are going to be watching on TV, you know, that sort of information, mm-hmm. you know, makes the increase go down a little bit easier, perhaps. If you know
well,
what the
reason
is, rather than just looking at a number and say, well, it went up X number of percent and X number of dollars, and mm-hmm. if you put it in the context of a why.
Scotty?
Yeah. Pick on the drivers, that's all.
Actually, if I could, Mr. Chair, we have, and I appreciate what you're saying about what the drivers actually are. If you look at our big three drivers, right, benefits and insurance at 91,000 total, so about nearly 65 is just health. It's, excuse me, I've got garlic coming roaring to the top. Frenchman and garlic don't always go well together. Anyway, and then 152 for Ed. The question I wrote down here was, under the benefits explanation, is it an increase in enrollment? Is it a benefits expansion, right? Or are there any added employees? How does it actually end up working out? And those three things are the drivers for that. And I can give some narrative here, and I'll have some homework before town meeting. We have been right at our enrollment projected expense budget based on current enrollment with an addition of one or two. And that is usually through the elementary schools. If they pick someone up, whether it's turnover or somebody switches plans, if we don't actually have that money in an appropriation, we end up getting it at the special the following year. And so we have to be able to appropriate for it. The treasurer collector came in this year during her budget presentation, was actually pretty clear, saying, we've done it for 3 years. It always leaves me a little sketched out, because what happens if we get two more enrollments and someone changes jobs or they lose their spouse's coverage and there's no appropriation? So the recommendation this year was at least appropriate four, and I think it's two. That come in, and those values are the driver here. Now, we don't have necessarily those people, but not budgeting for them in years prior would have us going back and doing it in the rears. So I think those three areas, if I could, maybe to a conversation point, is enrollment stable, right? Has the benefit expanded? And then are we adding staff? So enrollment and staff are very different. We could hire somebody and they choose not to. They look at it 55% and chuckle. And I would say again, we have been notified by both the state and the federal government that, you know, we're teetering on the edge of affordability by definition. So Maybe those are talking points. That might get a little too deep in the weeds on the town meeting, but at least we can do the talking points around it.
Well, I think I understand what the moderator's saying.
Yeah, I agree.
He's saying that sometimes there may be a misconception that we're overly generous on certain
right.
areas.
Yeah.
And because people don't, we know. Something we deal with all the time, but sometimes the people, because they hear of state, federal, local employees, or maybe some towns are given 100% benefits, or 95% benefits, or 90% benefits, and there's still some schools, districts that do that. We don't. Matter of fact, we've negotiated at Frontier. I know in the teacher's contract there, we've negotiated those percentages down over the last couple contracts, mm-hmm. and we've been very interesting conversations with the school about doing that, and the teachers union, and don't get it wrong, the teachers union understands, the unions understand,
yep.
They understand, right. But see, we know that, but sometimes we don't talk about that. When the school administration said the other day that you look at Sunderland, its cost per pupil,
right.
We may think we're spending a lot of money on our students, But when you ask them, they say we're in the what, the bottom third?
Bottom third.
Now, and you can kind of make numbers say whatever you want them to say, because because when you look at that, you can say we get a lot of our school choice kids. Those towns are paying more.
Right.
But we're getting their children. I think we have a great, our schools, many communities strive to get schools that we take for granted in school union 38.
Yeah, there is an important disconnect between them in the narrative, that is cost of attendance versus quality of the education. One's pretty tangible, one's a number. The other is you're setting the trajectory of a young person for their lifetime. You know, how are you doing? I don't know. What are those measures? Standard testing? I don't know.
It's an interesting conversation. And if you'd look, and I think Hadley Elementary is less than Sunderland Elementary, so I think they're like 12 something, and ours is 13 something. So it's hard just to look at the numbers, but I think if people could say, well, we're spending a lot of money in school. Yeah, we are. We're getting a good return on that money, but it's not as much as a lot of our neighbors, and not talking about eastern part of the state. So yeah, I hear what you're saying. But we kind of know that. But it's hard to get that boy out there.
The interesting thing is that the people who come to town meeting, there's, I don't know if you want to call them two different groups. One group comes with the idea that, you know, let's vote this thing and get out of here ASAP. And then there's another group that's, you know, they want to come and find out what's really going on. And you're trying to balance between those two groups in terms of, you know, what you're going to present for information.
Sure.
Well, and it's hard for us because I think more people watch us on TV than we think. And I think they're very attuned to, I think many people are very attuned to the budget.
I have no idea how many people watch on TV.
I haven't seen our Nielsen ratings lately, you know.
I don't know. I just know from my, I just know conversations I have with people.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The people I talk to seem very, and you don't get a lot of the newspapers, so I know it's not coming from them. But there's a lot of information that's coming, that has to be coming from TV. I'm not saying they watch the whole meeting, because heaven forbid.
That's why we moved the meeting to the end, because it was a high point.
But
I think you're right about that, though, about the number of people.
I would say that town meeting is a great place to. You know the interesting thing to me was the other night we were talking about the 120 North Main Street, and one of the gentlemen asked a question about why are we giving the property to the developers, and it's like, oh, we had this, that's actually not really germane to the question that's on the article, because we've already discussed that. We've already said we could do that. But it's an interesting question because it comes back to the information that someone has or doesn't have. And we kind of thought everybody knew why we wanted to do that. I did. And when I heard the question, it was like, I made sure I talked to Lauren afterwards to say, by the way, make sure you have, if the moderator allows a conversation to go there, you may want to get some of your slides from past presentations keyed up, because we may have to use those again. But you're right, I think the best place to come is to come to, especially on the budget, is come to the finance committee and or the selectman meeting and ask those questions, because if you ask a question of the budget before town meeting, I think you can get a lot more accomplished than if you ask, because we've been dealing with it since January. So we're pretty set and firm in our positions. Not that they can't change, but we're pretty, you know, we think we've gone through and we've put the best numbers that we can on the paper in front of people. So the time to come is coming February and March. That's when I think you can have the most bang for your buck. But for some reason, people don't come out. That, you know, like you said, they'll come to a town meeting, and that's a prerogative. And they may walk away sometimes feeling like their voice wasn't heard, but it's difficult. It's difficult to answer some of those questions because we have the documentation, but it's hard. It's hard, you know, because it's almost like you're recreating the budget.
Right, you're rehashing all the work that went into it in one meeting.
In one segment of the meeting too.
Exactly. Right, just question A or whatever. Yep.
But again, it's a prerogative, and I mean, we'll answer questions. And I think, you know, someone answers any question, I think over the years we can explain our positions. But you're probably right. I don't looking back on it, I think we can support the numbers that the school put forward. I think all the departments that put forward, I think we can support those numbers. I mean, look, I don't think the last few weeks with the library has been my personally finest hours talking about the budget, but we still talked about it. And I understand, you know, I understand what their positions are. It's tough to deal with your neighbors and your friends having differences of opinion, and you're both established. And I look at, and for me, I look at the town, and I look at some positions I think are underfunded, and the library is looking at positions that they think are underfunded, and we're all trying to do the same thing. Sometimes you just have to agree to get there, and that's the hard part. That really is. And I think we have gotten there, but if we want to keep moving our town in the forward direction, we're going to have this override, and make no mistake about it.
Yeah, I think it was really interesting in the conversation last week with people who weren't, if I could, Mr. Chair, who maybe missed the point that Richard Lopatka made about COLAs and percentages. That the tops of the scale, the percentages are different than people who are, you know, working for $14 or $15 an hour. And we have those people on our payroll. Mm-hmm. So if you're a salaried employee at 55 grand and you're making $15 an hour, the percentages grow. That same, and I use this, I think I mentioned this that night, that same thing happens year on year when we are 300 and change taking in 160. And the next year is 300 and more and we're taking in 160. And the gap goes and goes and goes and goes. And I would suggest after the 2009 exercise with a reduction in state aid and having postponed a reset of the rate for 20 years, that number was not just daunting, it became really almost impossible. So now we're at a midpoint in that 10 plus, well, nearly 10 year span. And we're talking about covering not just the costs of government, but also some measure of growth. And again, I go back to the point, I'll say this more times than not, just because the Board of Selectmen is placed on the warrant with the advice of the Finance Committee, the request for a $300,000 override, does not mean we have $300,000 of baked in expenses. This is the capacity to raise. That's really important to bear in mind. Next year you could have a very, very lean budget. At least you could raise the money.
I think that's an important point.
It is.
Point that out.
Sure. Yeah. So I would suggest that if depending on all the numbers fall, if that override passes, we would need, based on this sheet, to raise an additional $59,000. That we have a red, there's a red 59,590 right here at the bottom of the sheet. It's coming from somewhere.
Somewhere.
Right.
Right. All right. Are we all set with that? I mean, we'll try. Scotty?
One last point.
Yep.
the good thing about town meeting when it comes to budget or any of the articles, I don't have to hesitate to ask you guys for the answer or share it, because I know that you guys are gonna have the answers. And for somebody that's the moderator, that's a reassuring feeling.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Ms. Moderator. We appreciate that. I mean, we work hard on that. And it goes back a number of years now, Mike Wissman included.
Tony Leger.
Tony Leger. We really strive to be able to answer those questions, the hard questions. And again, the budget's our opinion. And if someone has different ideas or thoughts, we're willing to listen to them. That's why we have joint meetings with the finance committee. I mean, we don't fight with our finance committees. Like, I mean, we may have different opinions, but we're not going to fight with them, because I mean, we want to listen to their thoughts as well. So, all right, Mr. Scott, we need to do anything on the capital plan? Has anything changed?
The only thing that we're waiting for right now is an additional almost $11,000 from the highway superintendent, and that has to do with, and I'm looking for my capital sheet, has to do with the failing of the fuel delivery system. He's got that coming forward. But as of right now, the answer is no.
Okay, so we're all set?
Yep.
Now, one of the things on the capital is that we do have a new police cruiser replacement.
Good point.
Inside of there. Unfortunately, we had one of our officers had an accident. The cruiser was described by an insurance company as totaled. They're projected to give us around 35,000. That was one we were going to replace. They gave a replacement at $35,000. So instead of looking at $47,000 from capital stabilization, looks like we're only going to have to spend about $17,000.
Right. So not a tactic you want to take at home, crashing a nearly 10-year-old cruiser.
So the good news is that the officer wasn't hurt, the person that hit him wasn't hurt, and we're going to get some insurance money to help cover it. We don't need to do that again in the future, but it's, the way it worked out this year is fine.
It's not the best way to replace your cruisers.
Bob, are you staying to talk about the motions?
What's that?
Are you staying to talk about the motions?
No, I just came to see what you're talking about tonight as far as...
Okay.
We could talk about the moving of free cash while he's here?
Yeah, go ahead.
As we come in, and the board hasn't heard this yet from me, we have this balance of accounts, like free cash, stabilization, you know, where all the money's come in. And this year we had an anomaly with respect to free cash. We also have a free cash policy that is essentially a third is used for funding the operating piece forward. We try to leave it in the kitty to fuel the next year's free cash. And then of the 66% that's remaining, we take and we parcel out between operating budget growth in a given year. Again, it's free cash is a bit of a misnomer. And then stabilization and capital stabilization. And those move, we've done this now three or four years. This year we have an extraordinarily high an anomaly of free cash, over $700,000, and we can explain it. We need to know where that came about. We know it came about because of closing of accounts that were carried forward through the budget years, and the auditors really said that those have to be long since closed. Let's put that toward what's called a category called undesignated funds that rolls into free cash. So we took those steps last year. We also had in the accounting, the categorizing step on the recap sheet, how the capital stabilization rate was actually captured. So that fed some free cash for a couple of years. We expect usually in the 280 to 340, 350 in free cash, and we allocate the 70 and the 80, and then we move forward with the remainder. This year, there's, I'm going to pose to the, we're about to talk about before you roll out of here. If we follow the formula, which was really designed while we had a predictable value of free cash, we put some in stabilization, some in capital stabilization. If we follow that formula this year, we would put $227,000 in capital stabilization. Now, I'm an advocate for capital stabilization. However, I would suggest that this year, asking for voters to hopefully endorse a $300,000 override, then I'm gonna ask the board to consider reducing that number and putting the larger value in stabilization. And here's why. If we go through if all the stars line up, and we find out that we can buy out a piece of debt, either the public safety complex or the library, there's some question about whether you can use capital stabilization for those funds. So preemptively, I'd ask the board, and we're about to talk before you run out of here, to change the numbers on the motion. They won't exclusively reflect the warrant. So that'll be, they won't reflect the warrant. The numbers will be different than the actual warrant article, and that's a point of discussion I'm willing to, if it moves forward, then I'm willing to explain during town meeting. So when you look at the motions on Friday night, don't go, Jesus, I left, what happened? So that's a long-winded way of saying we might move some out of capital and put it in stabilization if we find that stabilization is a little more flexible than capital stabilization by definition. So it helps us if we need it in the future. Anyway, sorry about that. Thank you, Mr. Chair. That was long-winded.
Bob, any questions about that? All right. So, let's go start through the warrant. We're all set with a capital.
Yep.
Capital plan.
Correct.
All right. Motions.
So the warrant in front of us, we have motions to include everything.
Mm-hmm. Right. So.
So we're looking at the motions now, not the warrant.
Yeah. This is the motions. Okay. So. Article 2. $9,043.45.
Bills from
those
prior
are past
years.
Bills.
Yep, bills from prior years.
No questions about that. Basically, coming from free cash.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then the summary of the bills is below that value.
Yep.
Total. Yep.
Article 3.
Move to recommend.
Second.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0, Sherry. Article 3 is the elected members' salaries.
And these are in line with.
Any other questions? All those in favor? Motion.
A motion to recommend.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Article 4 is the budget, total budget, raise and appropriate to sum of $7,054,247, appropriate from the ambulance reserve fund to $20,000, appropriate from fund 318 Comcast PEG access fund, a sum of $29,000. Again, that's to pay for things that are audiovisual,
right?
For the town. Fund 610 WW wastewater treatment, sum of $338,791, appropriate from town. Fund 419 Title V, the sum of $5,063, appropriate from free cash, value of $127,144, for the sum total of $7,574,245.
There is a language piece we have to discuss here.
It's set forth in the document titled Town of Sunderland Budget. Provided, however, that the vote taken here under shall be expressly contingent upon approval of the voters of a Prop 2.5 so-called override question, allowing the town to raise the additional sum of $300,000 outside the limits imposed by the said two and a half in accordance with Mass General Law, Chapter 59, Section 21. Now, that's there because basically we have to come back to another town meeting. If it doesn't pass, that special would be scheduled for, well, actually, Mr. Moderator, do you want to when at the end of Friday night, if we get through all the articles, do you want to dissolve the meeting or do you want to recess the meeting until June 16th?
It's either call a special or extend, I guess, is the line of questioning, right?
Yeah, it's how do you want to handle it? I mean, now, my opinion, if you dissolve it, we start clean on the 16th. If you don't, if you recess it, then anything, the Rule of Seven, or there a lot of things could occur.
Right.
I mean, we could change.
The warrant stays open, all that. Yeah,
right. So right now, if we come back, basically, it'd be to discuss the budget. So would you want to dissolve? So right now, we're looking, we have everything set up for June 16th.
Because that's been confirmed with the school and everyone's.
So everybody's set to make that.
Oh, we're telling you for the first time.
No, they talked. So we'll dissolve the meeting then? Okay.
Could I ask, Mr. Chair, of the discussion here on the motion that is for Article 4?
Hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
We have guidance. We have a bit of a choice here and guidance from town council. If you look at the line under all of the numbers that says, quotes, Town of Sunderland FY18 town meeting budget provided, however, that the vote taken here under shall, which is not Hal, but he was a good computer. Be expressly contingent upon approval by the voters of the town 2.5 override. I get that. The term provided, however, in legal form allows for and requires that the total budget process is opened up again. So this is contingent. If we remove the term provided, however, and leave it contingent, then the vote itself can be funded through the override. So there's two paths for us. There's one is the whole process can open up again because we don't have a level budget.
Right.
And if that's the goal, then town council said you can do it either way. By having it
we shouldn't confuse.
Yeah.
How do we want to do it? Is this, do you want to do it this way or do you want to do it another way?
I think it would be cleaner to remove provided, however.
Well, I would agree.
It's still contingent.
It's still contingent, right. But you're just changing the wording.
Correct.
From a legal standpoint.
Correct. Again, this process, and maybe Sherry can weigh in on this a little bit. This term provided, however, that the vote taken expressly contingent has a connotation that allows for all of the expense line reviews all over here. We're not talking just about the funding side.
Right.
If you leave provided, however, in there, that means there's no budget and everything's up for grabs when we go back.
Well, we start completely from scratch.
Completely over. If you delete it, if you take that out, we have the budget there and we just have to address the amount that we're over. Whether we reduce it or we use reserve funds or a combination of the two. So we would be addressing, say, that $60,000 deficit versus a whole budget.
I think with the quality of the information that we have and the fact that the town has seen us do budgets year after year after year and the fact that it's just facts. There's no shenanigans here. I would suspect that the budget discussion would go through on the 16th without anything more than traditional annual discussion. However, there is opportunity in there.
Yeah.
So, just came this afternoon. I thought it was important to discuss.
I'd just rather leave. I'd rather just open up the entire. I mean, if the override doesn't pass, God, I'd better be able to talk about everything.
Oh, I agree, including expense reductions.
Absolutely, yeah.
Absolutely right. Fine. Again, this it doesn't change the bar for our burden of proof to the town about the budget. it does leave the budget bare. As opposed to out of balance.
You have to deal with this after. You have to have a budget in place by when?
July 1st.
July 1st. June 16th, we should be. Huh? What's that?
We've got June 16th, that's enough.
Well, no, as long as it's voted prior to July 1st, we're okay. Again, it was just point of discussion.
I think we're all, I mean.
So to leave it as is, and I'll fix shall.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. With that, and I appreciate.
Yeah, I mean, if the override passes, we're all set.
Yeah.
It's a no-brainer. If the override fails, then we open up the budget. Come back, and we don't do it again. We're not dragging everybody in a room to start all over again. On the contrary, the framework exists, but the reductions, if the reductions are required, or the use of additional funds and revenues, that's a very active discussion,
right.
and should be.
Okay.
Thank you for the dialogue. Motion to recommend Article 4.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Article 5. Transfer from free cash a sum of $127,557 to the stabilization fund.
Mr. Chair, if I could, I would move to change. I would ask the board to entertain changing the number of $127,557 to $277,557, and that is changing by $150,000 the value that we move, that is projected to move in the next article, to capital stabilization. That would reduce our this would reduce our transfer to capital stabilization to $77,144. That would leaving capital stabilization an additional $79,000+, which I think is fine for the year. However, it would take total stabilization. We're starting at $342,481. If we do this addition of $277,557, we would leave town meeting with stabilization of $620,038.
Yeah, we can move that around in the next meeting anyways, if we have to.
Right, but the motion, I think, I'd like to change this motion.
Yeah, that's fine.
So the number is?
I'd like to change the motion to from free cash to stabilization to $277,557. An additional $150,000 to stabilization.
Motion.
Motion.
I'll second. Move to recommend.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Article 6.
Mr. Chair, if I could put before the board a recommendation to change 227,144 to 77,144. That again moves the value.
Yep.
So this would be 77,144.
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0.
And again, Mr. Moderator, if I could, when we talk about these moves on this use of free cash sheet, the ledger that we see here, that leaves us both with free cash moving forward of $133,000. It leaves us moving out of town meeting at stabilization value of $620,038. It leaves us moving town meeting with capital budget, if the capital budget is voted, with a remaining balance of $79,197.
Article 7, move the town vote to appropriate from capital stabilization sum of $124,000, a sum of $10,000 from Fund 318 Comcast PEG Access, and $11,275 from the sewer reserve, for a total of $146,002 for the fiscal year 2018 capital budgets. We have what's on the capital budget?
Yeah, we'll have a summary of the budget. We have these here. And
yep.
Their lines, we'll have a summary of that in an individual handout, just the capital budget.
You want to read down what it
is?
Yeah.
All right, so the capital budget this year is highway office mini split,
yep.
$4,000.
Correct.
Highway storm drain replacement of $10,000.
Correct.
Highway truck lease payment, year one of $27,206. Historical grave library improvement of $9,000, put a new heater in, right?
Yep, and this is actually year two of a three-year plan.
Yep. Library HVAC compressor, that's been part of the building maintenance plan for a while now.
Yep.
Police cruiser replacement of $15,567. Police evidence room monitoring of $2,150. Administrative accounting software of $14,671.
I think it's important to bear in mind, Mr. Chair, that there may be discussion around that, and the statute that governs capital definitions now includes software because of its life cycle.
Oh, yeah.
It's a big nut, you know, anyway.
Sherry, administrative buildings needs assessment.
Mm-hmm.
What's that?
It's for an engineering study of all of the town buildings for our capital to look at, like a structural analysis, roofing, window, any kind of capital repairs that may need to be done.
Yeah.
What this does is it gives us a 10 to 20 year window for capital planning based on the individual asset.
$8,632 for administration technology improvements.
I think that's actually streetlights, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. What's that? Oh, sorry, yeah, streetlights. Administrative streetlights.
Yep.
8,000.
So this is the first phase in buying out our contract with Eversource, and then the second phase is Green Communities, Sherry.
Right.
Yep. Green Communities LED. For LED replacements.
Convert them. Yep.
And the goal there, of course, is to not only have longer service infrastructure through the LED lighting, but also a reduction in our energy costs. So this is one part of a two-part program to get us out of HEPA sodium and put us all LED, but we end up owning them.
Okay. All right, so motion?
Motion.
I'll second.
Motion made and seconded, Article 7 for capital stabilization plan, although, Scott, what was the initial capital?
Over 600.
Request? Over 600,000.
We had a fire truck. Actually, and I could, Mr. Chair, we can talk briefly about this at town meeting. Even this value as presented has been pared down.
Right. All right, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0, Article 8.
The quantum of votes, 5, 6, and 7, those are all two-thirds, right? Because they involve stabilization.
Yep. Either in or out, correct.
In or out, yep. Requires
two-thirds.
Yep. Mm-hmm. There was a change under the Municipal Modernization Act.
No way.
Yep.
Really?
Don't tell me they made it easier.
Yeah, they did.
I wish they'd keep it two-thirds.
I think in is majority.
To put them in?
Two-thirds, but I'll double check.
To put in.
Oh, to transfer in would actually make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll
right, it's out that you'd want to.
All right, Article 8, $20,874.70 for the Sunderland Library backyard enhancements.
This is CPA money now.
Yeah.
This is important to bear in mind.
All right.
Move to include.
Second.
Move to recommend, I'm sorry.
Do you have a second?
Yeah, second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Article 9 is $17,583 for Community Preservation Fund Historical Resource Reserve for the historic preservation purposes of Town of Sunderland Records and Rehabilitation Program under the direction of the town clerk.
This is both cataloging and organizing?
Right.
Great. Okay. Move to recommend.
Second.
And actually, this goes one step further than that. It's to assist also with the new open meeting
public
record law.
Right.
So all those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Article 10, this total sum $100,000 from CUNY Preservation, which comes from the Community Housing Reserve, and $51,000 shall from the undesignated budget reserve to fund the Sunderland Affordable Senior Housing. Motion?
Move to recommend.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0.
And this is the This is the raise for the upcoming year, is Article 11?
Article 11 is the machinations that the CPA has to go through to make sure that the money's in the right, distributed in the right accounts. Recommendation?
Move to recommend Article 11.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Article 12 is free cash for the Sunderland Anniversary Celebration Fund.
I saw an email changing the number, so.
To 105, yep.
Yeah, okay.
Yep. Recommendation?
Move to recommend.
Second.
All those in favor? Any discussion?
Aye.
Well.
They're not going to override this, they're the override.
Good point. It's a one-time expense, so it's not. I understand. You're asking why. I'm trying to get there. It's, you have one opportunity to, there's one opportunity to celebrate and enhance a community's at this 300th anniversary. The $100,000 is going for, I can tell you how, there's money in there for a parade. And the expenses of a parade. They have, and this is the high number. It doesn't include the revenue that's coming back, or they hope to get, or the sponsors for, like when the moderator sponsors a marching unit. You know, who gets it?
The marching moderators?
Marching moderators.
Oh, there you go. I like the sound of that. It's a good name.
So this would help fund them. And again, I personally, you know, when you look at the parade, the fireworks, many of the functions are going to be self-supporting, but some need, the bigger ones need assistance, but the bigger ones, the bigger functions are what ties or gets the community involved to support the lesser ones. You said it the other day, we don't have the businesses that a town like Hadley has. Or some of the other communities to be able to support something like this. And again, I think it's a one-time fund, one-time expenditure of money. You could take this $100,000 from free cash. You could apply it to this year's budget to get through the override, to not have an override. But guess what happens next year? Instead of having a $300,000 override, we have a $405,000 override or whatever. And the last time we did an override, we were told that the biggest problem we failed is because we asked for too much.
Right.
So.
I would, if I could, Mr. Chair.
Shoot.
I would hope that with the motivation of the working group that's in charge of this, that this article and this motion would play out not unlike a capital piece where we would appropriate the money and any money underspent would be allocated back. And I use the example of the $100,000+ culvert that came in at under $40,000, and that money was put right back into stabilization. So again, I applaud the effort. I think it's a laudable goal. I would hope that the planning committee has a whole bunch of paperwork or post-it notes or somewhere there's a wall that says this costs $20 and this costs $20,000 and this and this and this is how we're going to raise an offset. And wish them the best.
It does. Yeah. And I think you got to listen. But again, I mean, you're asking me what I think is yeah, you know, you could have, I mean, you have one opportunity, and it's not it's going to be, you know, there's things taking place over the entire course of the year. It's not that one. You know, part of the things are you're having walk up at the Patty Farm. You know, how many people, I mean, the Patty Farm's a, I think people would be surprised, you know. Immigration today seems to be a big, big topic. I think if people in Sunderland knew the history behind Patty Farms and it happened here in Sunderland. You can go back into the minutes of 1932, and I've read those minutes out of town where we talked about the Polish immigrants causing us a hardship in our schools because we had to pay, but they didn't know English. It had. I'm just saying, it's always been there.
Right.
Now instead of Polish, it speaks Cambodian or just Spanish or whatever. But I think they had the Patty Farm. They have a geological. They're talking about the ghost, doing the ghost thing once more. There's going to be a dance that's actually all self-sufficient, gala dance that's going to be held in November.
Nice.
Over in the Blue Heron, that's all arranged, 200 reservations. I'd buy your ticket early. I think that's going to be Jeff Holmes' band, I believe, is playing at that. And you may not agree.
Well, if nothing else, that's a place to talk about it, too. Is it the
place meeting? To talk about it. But I think they deserve the opportunity to make their case. Mm-hmm. So, and I think that it's you only get one opportunity. So we have a motion, 105, and seconded.
Yes.
Any more discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Article 13.
Citizens petition.
What was that?
Citizens petition.
Yep. Citizens petition. Do you want to make a recommendation on this?
We certainly can.
I hope so. Basically, it's a Supreme Court decision back in 2010 that says corporations had the same right as individuals, and this petition is looking for an amendment to the Constitution, the United States Constitution, that basically says that corporations aren't individuals. Do we have a motion?
I move to recommend.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. Move that the 14 is allow the town of Sunderland to opt in to Chapter 90-17C, which hereby reduces the speed limit from 30 to 25 on any and all town roads. Limit from 30 to 25 on any or all town roadways within a thickly settled or business district. That the selectmen can do this.
Correct. And this came, the history, of course, is the. We were approached about a particular road, but to get below that 30, you had to adopt the statute.
Right.
And it has to. There's a density definition. It's not like this is going to become townwide. However, it will be in areas that have high density or business, and that's important to bear in mind. And I give both Sherry and the police chief credit coming forward with the request, and then frankly unearthing the fact that we had to adopt the law. We had to adopt it. If we didn't do that, we could, you know. Frankly, run amok. Move to recommend Article 14.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Article 15 allows Frontier to use the remaining, authorize the Frontier Regional and School Union District to use the remaining $8,847.47 of the $14,748.50 originally appropriated under Article 11 of the 2004 annual town meeting for repairs and re-roofing the central office for the cost of relocating the central office to the Frontier Regional Middle High School.
Move to recommend.
Second.
All those in discussion?
Mr. Chair, the town embarked on the purchase and renovation of the building in Waitley, and I understand why the administration is proposing the use of these funds to get out of that building. It would be nice, it will be nice in future years to understand what the disposition of that building is. It also will be nice to remind people that there was $600,000+ over a 5-year period invested in that building. And then the building was moved out of.
Less than 10 years ago.
Less than 10 years ago.
Can I ask why this is on? It doesn't have to be on.
They need to have it voted because it was voted specific language for the central office.
What's that?
It was voted for re-roofing.
Specific allocation.
Okay.
It actually.
We already did it.
We know. We know.
All right, motion made. Do you second it?
Yeah, second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Article 16.
This is a bit clunky, only in that this allows us to adopt, and maybe Sherry can weigh in here. We have been in practice exercising the use of revolving funds. That is, a service is rendered, a fee is paid, and the fee goes to the service provider, building inspector, wiring inspector, et cetera, et cetera. It doesn't go through the general government town coffers. However, this right here actually adopts a statute saying, hey, now that you've been doing it forever, you can actually adopt the statute and...
It's a bylaw.
And now it's a bylaw.
And you know, Bob, it's interesting.
I don't mean that tongue-in-cheek, by the way. It's all been very above board, but here now it becomes a bylaw and it's... Anyway.
You know, when you go back about the budget, about what we spend, you know, you look, we have wiring inspector, plumbing inspector, Board of Health,
right.
Fire inspector, all of those inspectors, if they're not working, they don't get paid.
Right.
I mean, so they're working for their fees.
Yep.
And you know, so if somebody say, well, you got an electrical inspector and you just pay him $9,000 a year. And how many inspections does he do? How many inspections does he do?
$9,000 worth.
Well, guess what? If he doesn't have a lot of business, he gets whatever percentage that, whatever the inspector fees are, they get certain fees. But that's what they get.
No. They wouldn't be eligible for any benefits.
All this does is codify in both adopting the statute and creating a bylaw what we already do.
So again,
no changes.
I think we, you know, the only, and you notice that the building inspector is not done under the revolving.
Correct.
For one basic reason, because the building inspector is called upon many additional times to help enforce our zoning bylaws, as you know. So there has to be compensation for that, and he has to have, for most of the part. Building, when electrical inspector goes out, he's looking for things to be done by code. There's a certain code that says you have to do this. He's not really discussing with the electrician beforehand what he's doing there, because the electrician, if he's a licensed electrician, should know that he needs X amount of outlets along the wall, et cetera, so. But the building inspector has to have hours, so that's why we don't pay him by revolving it. So we have a motion.
Move to recommend Article, which one?
16.
16.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
3-0. 17.
17 is the zoning.
And this is actually, for Article 17 is basically what the planning board did is made the Code of Sunderland easier to understand,
right.
The bylaws.
Right.
Another attempt. So, all those in favor? We already recommended this.
Correct.
Yep.
And then we have the consent articles.
Move to recommend the consent articles.
Motion second. Made to consent. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
3-0. All right, we're all set with that. Any questions, Mr. Moderator?
Yeah.
You say that every time.
Pacific time, maybe.
Every
okay.
time. I like it.
Scott, any questions?
Not with respect to the motion. So I appreciate the board's flexibility in changing those values around.
Yeah, okay. It makes sense after the discussion.
All right.
Yep.
All right. Selectman updates?
One more Police Negotiation Meeting this Thursday. We've accelerated our every other week schedule to try to wrap up before town meeting. We are actually meeting on Thursday, and we really have one area that we're exploring. And frankly, I think it's been a very healthy discussion, in particular in this area about longevity and seniority and rank. It's interesting. How a simple question, I love a good simple question, and it can turn into, you know, I didn't think about that. That's a good point.
Just because the question is simple doesn't mean the answer is.
Correct. Great point, Dan.
Okay, Dave, do you have anything to add?
No, not this week.
Sherry?
I'll be attending the TIP meeting tomorrow afternoon at Berkeley.
Oh, I saw that thing. Yeah.
We're still on schedule for North Main for 2020.
Okay, I just wanted to add, Sherry doesn't do a lot of tooting her own horn, but we noticed that Sunderland just was awarded an additional grant for branding for the community. So Sherry, that's one of the things Sherry very quietly doing is putting us in line for a lot of these grants.
I have a lot of help.
Yeah. Huh?
You said branding?
So quietly. See, and you know, and that's when earlier today when the pathway committee, I had a resident in town talk to me. He says that there was no way that the town was going to ever have the money to do these upgrades, the sidewalks and et cetera. And the town, and I said, well, you're right. The town will never probably have that money to do on its own. But the way we're going with the process right now through Complete Streets and others, that's how we're doing it. And that's part of what Sherry's working on as soon as the grants. And even when, if we listen when Sarah was here earlier tonight, there's Sunderland in line for $400,000.
Yeah.
And we may have to kick in $40,000 of money. We could probably use Chapter 90 or whatever, but if you can use $40,000 to get you $400,000.
It's a pretty good return on your money, I'd say.
But that's what we are trying to do. That we're trying to leverage our citizens' money. And it's the same thing we're doing with the CPA money over at 120, trying to leverage our money to get something better or bigger or items that are necessary for the town. So you had anything else, Sherry?
No, that's it.
Town meeting starts at 7:00 this Friday at the elementary school. We invite everyone to attend. We still have, you don't have to be part of any council or anything. You if you're a registered voter in town, and I did have an interesting conversation with a family from India, mm-hmm. and they're like 6 months away from getting their citizenship, hopefully. And they own a house in Sunderland.
Nice.
And they can't wait to come to their first town meeting.
Good.
And I said, I wish we had 3,000
yep.
other people yeah. like you. Because,
yep, that's
because
the
we do
same
have,
way.
Well, yep. because that's how our town is governed.
That's correct.
And you know, and you know, you go back and look at why you do certain things, and town meeting having allowed to vote, to have an open discussion, those are good things, I think.
Couldn't agree more. It's, you know, I've described it in years past as primal democracy. Everybody's got one voice.
Yeah.
Get right in there.
Yeah, I think so.
Yep.
So come early. I mean, you can come, the doors open at 6:30, so you can come in, you can check in, you can talk to your neighbors, you can talk to your friends that you haven't seen for a while, so I'd recommend coming early so the town moderator can, start us up at right at 7:00 so we can get through it. The town reports are online, or you can pick them up here at the town office building if you want. So I think we're ready to go. Anybody have any questions, give us a call. Deerfield's having their town meeting tonight, so I wish them well. Whiteley is Tuesday night.
Right over there.
I think Whiteley is Tuesday night.
Nice.
So I wish them well. and it's just a kind of a interesting time of the year.
Sure is. Mr. Chair, if I could.
Motion.
Well, I want to read a quote, if I could.
Oh, read your quote. Sorry, Mr. Bergeron.
This one actually, as the weekend passed, was the March of Scientists. I chose a scientific quote today. A guy by the name of John Desmond Bernoff, who was a early X-ray crystallography pioneer, because we needed those. And he wrote, at the very beginning of one of his books, he wrote, quote, there are, and this is, I think, fitting for town meeting, there are two futures, the future of desire and the future of fate, and man's reason has never learnt to separate them.
Hmm.
True.
Anyway, it's a great book called The Scientist as Rebel by an author named Freeman Dyson. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
The other thing is I would be remiss is today is also the Holocaust Memorial Remembrance Day. Mm-hmm. So if you have an opportunity, and I guess that's why it was very poignant the other day when they talked about... Mm-hmm. In the national news, it wasn't that long ago. I remember the first time I went. To Paris, and that was like 1984, and I remember being in the taxi, thinking, going down the Champs-Élysées, about thinking 40 years before,
mm-hmm.
and I was 23, 24 at the time. But it really wasn't 40 years at that time. 40 years wasn't that long ago, and an occupying force was marching down those streets. So we should not forget what happened. Some people have. We should not forget what happened during that time, because we have fewer and fewer of our residents that were alive during that period of time. But just to remember, today is the day of remembrance of the Holocaust, and it would be important, I think, to just take a moment in your life to think about that. So, we have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We are declared out at 8:30. We will get back on it Friday at 6:30.
Different bat channel, different
3-0. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.